And I'll say you're very welcome as well to worship this morning, wherever you're worshiping with us. And to reinforce what Carol has just read out there, if you're thinking you'll never remember all of those details, I think that has been emailed out, Nigel, along with the weekly announcements, so that all the information is there. You don't have to carry it all away in your head. And if you need a copy of it, let us know and we'll get you a hard copy. Just in case you need it. But we come to worship the Lord, to praise him, and to offer our thanks for the blessings we have received. And we commence with our call to worship today. I want to read for you from Psalm 22 and begin at verse 25. From you comes the theme of my praise in the great assembly. Before those who fear you, I will fulfill my vows. The poor will eat and be satisfied. Those who seek the Lord will praise him. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. All the rich of the earth will feast and worship, and all who go down to the dust will kneel before him, those who cannot keep themselves alive. Prosperity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness, declaring to a people yet unborn, he has done it. The Lord has done it. Taken from the psalm, and we can think of what the Lord achieved when he sent his son to die on a cross. And he said, just before his death, it is finished. It is complete. The work of salvation was completed. But for us this morning, we'll sing together. And the words are taken from hymns and Psalms 691. Come, let us sing of a wonderful love, tender and true, out of the heart of the Father above, streaming to me and to you. may be seated. We come before the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Father, we come to praise you, to glorify you, to lift your name high, and to give you thanks for the many blessings you bestow upon us. We've been reminded of all the blessings you bestow. We are so richly blessed as we dwell in this land. We thank you for the provision of a healthcare system. We thank you for food that is freely available to us. And we thank you for the gracious outpouring of your love in Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. We thank you that all that he achieved for us on that cross of Calvary, that the work was complete. And we thank you that after his exaltation to your right hand, you did not leave us, but you sent us your Holy Spirit to be with us, to lead us, to guide us, to empower and equip us. So, Father, with the prompting of your Spirit, may we know your presence in this place with us today. And as we worship, Lord, with our songs and our prayers and our readings and the spoken word, may you take that worship that we offer to you and make it acceptable before your throne of grace. Father, we ask all of this in the name of Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Amen. I know that on the past couple of Sundays, while I haven't been with you on the two Sundays, but the past couple of Sundays, topics have been dealing with post-Pentecost in Scripture. We've been looking at the book of Acts and things that happened after Pentecost. You remember what Pentecost was, when the Holy Spirit was poured out upon the disciples and they went out and they began to speak and proclaim the name of Jesus in the streets of Jerusalem. And on that first day, when Peter stood up and addressed the crowd with the other 11 or the other disciples with him, 3,000 responded to the gospel call. And that was men. What about the women and children? They were there as well. So you had people responding to the gospel message. And then it was a couple of weeks ago, I spoke to you and used a little clip of Peter and John going into the temple at the Gate Beautiful and healing of that crippled man. How Peter had said to him, in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. And he had. And then we covered how that annoyed some people. The rulers, the temple leaders, the Sanhedrin. And they called Peter and John in. Well, they brought them in. And they gave them a nice little instruction. Don't speak anymore in the name of this Jesus. Don't perform any more miracles in the name of Jesus. And Peter and John said to them, is it better for us to obey God than to obey man? And they went out again. And what did they do? Did they keep quiet? Nope. They were back in the temple courts preaching and teaching in the name of Jesus. And so that annoyed the officials a bit more. So they brought them back in again. This time they told them, don't do it. But just to make sure you don't do it, we'll give you a flogging. So they flogged them and then sent them out, don't do it anymore. So they went out. Didn't keep quiet. Began to preach and teach again in the name of Jesus. And it tells us that the numbers believing had now reached about 5,000 men and the women and children. You have to count them as well. So they were all there. And that created a bit of a problem. You see, the numbers of people in the fellowship had grew, and they were sharing things, they were sharing all things, and that meant they were sharing food. But there was some of the Greek Jews felt that their widows weren't being cared for well enough. So it was decided that they would appoint 7 men to come and administer the food. Just simply make sure everybody got an equal share that was due to get it. But as things progressed, some of those 7 men began to preach and teach as well. And one of them was preaching and teaching, brought before the Sanhedrin, and he spoke to them and he told them exactly what Peter and John had said to them. So they decided they'd go a bit better than flogging this time. They stoned him to death. That was Stephen, the first Christian martyr. And it actually tells us in chapter 8 of the book of Acts what happened on the day that Stephen was stoned to death. Acts chapter 8, verse 1. On that day, a great persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. They'd been preaching and teaching in the name of Jesus. The Sanhedrin, the ruling council, had not liked it, so a persecution began to come against the members of the church. And they scattered all over the place. The apostles stayed in Jerusalem, but the others were scattered. And to hear what happens to one of them, I'm going to ask Stephanie to come and read for us now. Stephanie, if you'd come, please.
Acts chapter 8, starting at verse 26, Philip and the Ethiopian official. An angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Get ready and go south to the road that goes from Jerusalem to Gaza. This road is not used nowadays." So Philip got ready and went. Now an Ethiopian eunuch, who was an important official in charge of the treasury of the Queen of Ethiopia, was on his way home. He had been to Jerusalem to worship God and was going back home in his carriage. As he rode along, he was reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Holy Spirit said to Philip, "Go over to that carriage and stay close to it." Philip ran over and heard him reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. He asked him, "Do you understand what you are reading?" The official replied, "How can I understand unless someone explains it to me?" So he invited Philip to climb up and sit in the carriage with him. The passage of scripture which he was reading was this: "Like a sheep that is taken to be slaughtered, like a lamb that makes no sound when its wool is cut off, he did not say a word. He was humiliated, and justice was denied him. No one will be able to tell about his descendants, because his life on earth has come to an end." The official asked Philip, "Tell me of whom is the prophet saying this, of himself or of someone else?" Then Philip began to speak. Starting from this passage of scripture, he told him the good news about Jesus. As they travelled down the road, they came to a place where there was some water, and the official said, "Here is some water. What is to keep me from being baptized?" The official ordered the carriage to stop, and both Philip and the official went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord took Philip away. The official did not see him again, but continued on his way, full of joy. Philip found himself in Azonus. He went on to Caesarea, and on the way he preached the good news in every town. Thanks be to God.
Say thank you to Stephanie for reading that passage for us. Mention of Philip. Philip was another one of those 7 who had been charged with serving the food. But when they were scattered, Philip went to Samaria. It doesn't tell us which city he went to, just he traveled to a city in Samaria. And although Stephanie didn't read it in that passage there, he seems to have had a very successful ministry, whatever city he was in, because we would read earlier on that he preached in the name of Jesus, he healed the sick, and he drove out demons. So you have this man who had been commissioned, if you like, to serve food, to look after the physical needs, scattered to a city in Samaria, and there he begins to proclaim Jesus as Lord, having a successful ministry, working well, people coming to faith. And the Lord said to him, Philip, I want you to leave here. How many of us, if we're doing something and it's going well and it's successful, and somebody suggests we leave and move elsewhere, we go, but Philip didn't. He'd seen people come to faith. He'd seen people healed. He had driven out demons. But yet, as soon as that angel of the Lord spoke to him, we're told that immediately he began to set out on his journey. And all he'd been told is, Philip, want you to go south. Okay, Samaria's up here. Jerusalem's here. He was to go to the old road that leads to Gaza on the south. So he was to go back through Jerusalem and out the other side and onto the southern road. Didn't even ask, Lord, what city am I going to? What town? Because he wasn't. He was just going to that road. Because on that road, there was one man traveling in a carriage. He was an Ethiopian. He was a eunuch. And he had traveled to Jerusalem to worship his God. And now he was heading back. Well, he just wasn't an ordinary Ethiopian. Some have it he was a prime minister. He was a chancellor of Ethiopia. He looked after the treasury of Candace, the queen of Ethiopia. A man of influence and importance in his own nation. And he was traveling home. That's who Philip was to come to meet. But he didn't know it. Can you picture Philip standing there beside this road? All right, Lord, I'm here now. What do you want me to do? And then the angel of the Lord said to him, see that carriage, Philip? Run over to it. He runs over. Wonder what speed the carriage was running at. Did he have to run to keep up with it? Or was it traveling at a sort of walking pace? Was there an escort with this important man who were there to keep people away? But Philip got close enough and he could hear the man reading. Normally when we read, isn't it a silent process? How often do we actually read aloud? But that was the custom then, that when you read, it was aloud. So Philip knew what he was reading. He knew the scripture. And he recognized that he was reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. And then he took the bull by the horns and he said, trying to enter into a conversation with the man in the carriage, you know, it might not just have been the most advisable thing to do, but he said, excuse me, do you know what you're doing? Or do you know what you're reading there? And to his credit, the man in that carriage turned round and said, no. How can I understand it unless somebody explains it to me? And he invited Philip to come and join him in the carriage. Remember, Philip had been having a successful ministry in Samaria. And God had said to him, I want you to go south, Philip. And here he's now dealing with an individual. And beginning at that very passage of scripture, he was led like a sheep to the slaughter. He began to explain to him who the prophet was referring to. And brings him right down to the time that this was Jesus. This is Jesus of Nazareth, who was the Son of God, who was crucified, who died, was buried, and God raised him again to life. That's who the prophet was speaking about. And can I tell you about him? And off goes Philip again, sharing the gospel message, sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with one individual. And as they traveled along, as they spoke together, the eunuch must have come to that place where he put his faith in Jesus, because he saw some water and he said, "What's to stop me from being baptized? What's to stop me?" And so Philip goes down with him to the water, baptizes him in the name of Jesus in the water. And as they come up out of the water, Philip's taken away. And the Ethiopian is left. Tells us he was full of joy, he was rejoicing, and he carried on home. Do you ever wonder what sort of impact that man had on the people of Ethiopia? We don't know. Did he go back to Candace, his queen, and tell her all of this? Did he share that message with others, other officials? Did some people hear it from his lips, a gospel message about believing an arisen Savior called Jesus Christ? We don't know that. Sure we don't. But we know what happened to Philip. The Lord took him to another place, and there he began to preach and teach again. He worked his way around to Caesarea, and he kept on preaching and he kept on teaching. And as he did, the gospel message began to spread further and further and further. The Jewish ruling council, the Sanhedrin, had thought that they would stop the spread of this gospel message when they started to kill Stephen and a persecution broke out against the believers in Jerusalem. But what they actually did was they forced the message out. It went further. People began to believe, began to hear the gospel message. And they began to believe. And so more and more people began to hear that gospel message. And look at how simply Philip here was asked to spread the message. Go and get alongside a carriage with one man in it. Is that something that we can all do? Get alongside one person. And when the opportunity presents itself, we can tell them about this Jesus Christ that we believe is the risen Son of God. And what success could we have? There was a saying for a time, each one win one. Did you ever come across that one before? No? It was very simple. Each member of the church was being asked in a year to share the gospel message with one person. Each one, win one. If they were all successful, what did they do to the size of their congregation in a year? Doubled it. And then the next year, each one, win one. It doubled again. That's if it was successful. But people had to be willing to do it. Philip was having a successful ministry, and the Lord said to him, "Philip, go south." And he went. No, "Oh, but I was doing this, I was doing that." Go south. One man. The Lord cares for each individual. Who are you being presented with the opportunity to share the gospel with in your daily life? That's what it's about. It's sharing love one with the other It has been described in some places as one beggar finding a source of food and going and telling another. We have a source of life, and we want to share that with people that have life and need life. Are you willing to take the risk of sharing the gospel message? As we come out of this pandemic, as lockdown is eased and all the rest of it, will there be more opportunities for us to meet with people again? Will there be more opportunities to share our love of Christ with them? We don't need to wait for hardship and persecution. We can start proclaiming that love today. And the Spirit that empowered Philip and Stephen and the others is the Spirit of God, which rests and dwells in all who believe, and will equip you and give you the words to say when the opportunities arise. All you have to do is be obedient and take the opportunities. Let's pray. And we'll turn to our prayers of intercession. Father, we come before your throne of grace, and we want to thank you for the wonder of your word and how it can encourage and challenge us to take that message out. But at this time, we want to pray for those around us and pray for various settings and situations. And so we pray for the easing of the lockdown in our land, that it will be done in a sensible, measured way, and that we as the people, the inhabitants, the citizens of this land, will play our part, that we will not overstretch the mark and risk a spike, a resurgence in this virus. Guide us all, Lord, as we come out of this lockdown. And we think especially of the business owners who are potentially going back to trading for the first time in months, maybe concerned about the future of their business. So we just ask that you will guide them in all the preparations they need to make as the businesses start to open up and trade once more. And help us, Lord, to be supportive of the local businesses where that is feasible and possible. And we would also pray, Lord, for those who are in leadership in our land, our politicians, as they make decisions about how to ease the lockdown and to continue, and how to work with the continuation of the vaccination program. For those who currently lead and those who will lead in the future, we ask for your guidance and blessing upon them. And as this weekend we seem to mark the 100th anniversary of the founding of Northern Ireland as a state in its own right, we ask, Lord, that celebrations, events organised to mark this occasion, will be held in a dignified, reverent way, that there will be peaceful, there will be no unrest, no violence on our streets as a result of a celebration. So we would ask, Father, for your blessing upon all events that have been organised, that they will be carried out in a suitable, quiet, gentle manner. And Father, we think of the people in our fellowship and in our families, those who have been going through times of illness, those who have been sick. We ask, Lord, for healing in the physical sense, but we also ask that you, by your Spirit, Lord, will overcome the sense of fearfulness, the sense of dread or apprehension about moving out. For those who have been feeling isolated and alone, that, Lord, they will be able to move out into community once again. And yes, we remember those who were sorrowing. and grieving the loss of loved ones, that they might be comforted, that they might know peace. And we also remember the nation of India at this time, with a soaring death rate as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, a lack of medical care, a lack of vaccinations, a lack of oxygen. Father, for the nations around the world who are blessed with an abundance, may they share with the nations, not just India, but all the other nations who have so little. May there be a distribution of our wealth, the vaccines around the world. And Father, we just ask that you will hear our prayers as we today remember to stand in solidarity with our partners in the church in Poland. And we pray, God of love, we turn to you in prayer for our world, knowing that you hear us. Today we think of our brothers and sisters in Poland. Thank you, Lord, for the growing relationship between the Polish Church and the Northwestern District. May this relationship develop and be a blessing to all involved. In this challenging year, thank you for the response of the Church in Poland as they have continued to reach out and connect with the communities during lockdown and restrictions. We ask that you continue to give wisdom to their church leaders as they guide, support, and minister in these days. We pray for those in Poland who are ill with the virus and those bereaved by it. God, be their comfort. God, help us to be faithful in our prayers for others. In your name we pray. And in the name of Christ, we offer all our prayers. Amen. But we're going to sing, and you can see the words there. Broken for me, broken for you. The body of Jesus, broken for you.
Remembering, I is my blood I shed for you. For your forgiveness, making you new. Broken for me, broken for you. The body of Jesus
broken.
And you may take your seats as we come to the sharing. The words will appear for you here. Your responses are in bold. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Then we share together in the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We come together and we just remain seated for the thanksgiving. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, all-powerful and ever-living God, it is indeed right. It is our joy and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. You created all things and made us in your own image. When we had fallen into sin, you gave your only Son to be our Savior. He shared our human nature and died on the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand in glory, where he lives forever to pray for us. Through him you have sent your holy and life-giving Spirit and made us your people, a royal priesthood, to stand before you to proclaim your glory and celebrate your mighty acts. And so with all the company of heaven, we join in the unending hymn of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise you, Lord God, King of the universe, through our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this and eat it. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Therefore, Father, as he has commanded us, we do this in remembrance of him, and we ask you to accept our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we who receive your gifts of bread and wine may share in the body and the blood of Christ. Make us one body with him. Accept us as we offer ourselves to be a living sacrifice, and bring us with the whole creation to your heavenly kingdom. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be given to you, Almighty Father, from all who dwell on earth and in heaven, throughout all ages. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. And as we come to the words of what's known as the Prayer of Humble Access, I would ask you to say this with me. Lord, we come to your table, trusting in your mercy and not in any goodness of our own. We are not worthy even to gather up the crumbs under your table, but it is your nature always to have mercy, and on that we depend. So feed us with the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that we may forever live in him and he in us. Amen. I invite you, draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, and his blood, which was shed for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. And if you prepare your little containers, the body of the Lord Jesus Christ, which is given for you, keep you in eternal life. Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ has died, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for us, keep you in eternal life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Amen. Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet prepared for all mankind. Amen. And we turn to song once more from the hymns and psalms at 719. Soldiers of Christ, arise and put your armor on. Soldiers of Christ, arise.
Through his eternal.
And we return to the communion liturgy. The blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace in the power of the Spirit to live and work to God's praise and glory. Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen.